This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Healthful Sports for Young Ladies by St. Sernin. Preface. The most eminent physicians dwell particularly upon the necessity there is for young ladies, as they advance towards womanhood, to take active and regular exercise, and to avoid, as much as possible, all sedentary amusements. That love of variety, however, so natural to the human mind, and which is particularly observable in children, renders it a matter of some difficulty to diversify their sports, so as to discover a sufficient number of games that require exertion. We, however, flatter ourselves that this has been accomplished in the little work here presented to the reader in an English dress. They will find in it instructions for playing at a great number of games, of such a nature that they cannot fail of being conducive to their health, and which, while they afford an innocent relaxation from study, will be eminently useful in forming that easy and graceful carriage which can only result from the free and active motion of the limbs necessarily produced by frequently playing at these games. The prose part of the work has been faithfully rendered into English from the French original, but the proprietor is indebted to the author of the tours of the original Dr. Syntax, who has enriched this little repository of youthful sports with some elegant verses illustrative, in a moral point of view, of the games described. Chapter 1. The Swing. Madame Dernilly was accustomed to pass every year several of the summer months in the country. A particular circumstance obliged her to go there sooner than usual, and her husband, who was one of the chief magistrates in the capital, was not able to accompany her. Her only companions were her two daughters, both young girls. There was very little society to be met with in that part of the country where Madame Dernilly's castle was situated. The nearest town, which was at a distance of 2 or 3 leagues, was a small place, with but few genteel inhabitants, and, even were it otherwise, she would not have been tempted to mix with her neighbors. Solitude was her choice and her device till the time of the vacation. At that period she expected to be joined by her husband and her only son. The visits she received in the meantime were confined to those of two ladies in the neighborhood, and their daughters, and these were admitted only on condition that they brought with them no men, not even those of middle age. Adela and Ernestina, the daughters of Madame Dernilly, found this lonely life very dull. In fact, it suited ill with the vivacity of their age, and in order to enliven it, they managed to prevail upon the two ladies, their neighbors, to leave behind them, at the castle, 3 young persons who accompanied them there on a visit. This addition to the family was delightful to Adela and Ernestina, for they were equally in want of employment and amusement. They had read over and over all the books they brought with them from Paris. As their masters had not accompanied them, they did not pursue their studies regularly, but only took occasionally a few lessons upon the pianoforte and of singing, so that a great portion of their time was unemployed. A moralist has said with much reason that the mind requires relaxation, and as it is necessary to seek employment in order to preserve oneself from the evil habits which are the offspring of idleness, so it is equally requisite to relieve the fatigue of labor by recreation. A proper mixture of both keeps up the spirits and preserves the health of the mind as well as that of the body. In mixing with society, we lose the remembrance of past troubles, and even present ones weigh less heavily upon our spirits. The mind, in short, resembles a fruitful soil, like which it should sometimes be suffered to lie fallow. Or rather, it may be compared to a farmer with whom a landlord is obliged to act leniently, and to give him time for payment, for fear that by demanding his rent too strictly, the farmer's resources should fail, and he should be ruined. Our 5 young friends were not obliged to rack their brains to find amusement. In the beginning of the visit, the youngest, named Adriana, taught the grown-up girls those dances which they had learned in their childish days, but had already forgotten. My fine castle, we will not go again to the wood, the Duke de Bourbon, in C and C. These are things out of date we must allow, but they will always be new for children, and our imitations of them are, after all, lifeless copies. They want the spirit of the originals, the Chevalier de la Marjolaine, the Tower, take care, hands round, amused even Madame Dernilly, who herself did not disdain sometimes to join in them. The pleasure which they found in renewing their childish games gave to our young people the idea of taking advantage of a swing which was already erected in the garden. Persons of a more advanced age, and distinguished by grave occupations, did not look upon it as any disgrace to take the exercise of swinging during the months of August and September, when the castle was crowded with guests. The posts which supported the swing were a little decayed since the preceding year, but they were soon repaired. Madame Dernilly recommended prudence to the young people in partaking of this amusement, and, as an additional precaution, she took care to be present whenever they enjoyed it, and strictly ordered that no one should swing in her absence. They were prohibited standing upon the seat. Neither were two persons allowed to get in at the same time. Ernestina, or Aglaé, or another of their friends, placed themselves by turns upon the seat, which was furnished with a soft cushion, and while the one who took the exercise grasped the cords tightly with her two hands, two or three of her companions pulled the end of the cord, and thus made it go backward and forward. Satiety would not have interrupted this amusement, but bad weather came on suddenly, and it was impossible for our young folks to frequent the garden. Thus thwarted in their favorite sport, they set their wits to work to find out some other agreeable pastime. Adriana regretted the swing less than her playfellows. A new doll, which had been sent her from Paris, was her faithful companion, and, shall I add, the others envied her happiness. They contrived, however, to participate in it, for, under the sly pretense of amusing little Adriana, they made much of her doll. They took pains to dress her, to curl her hair nicely, and to put on her cap to the best advantage. They made dresses for her, and even pretty little rose-colored silk slippers. In short, the doll's drawers were soon completely filled with a very handsome wardrobe. They were just beginning to tire of the amusement, which making the doll's clothes had at first afforded them, when one morning Aglaé, one of the young visitors, happening to open a book by chance, read aloud, that it was by trying the effects of the reflection and the refraction of the light through the fragile partitions of soap bubbles that the great Newton had discovered the properties of the prism and decomposed the rays of the sun. Madame Dernilly expressed her admiration of this phenomenon in natural philosophy, but she did not understand the subject sufficiently to give her little auditors much information upon it. "But pray," cried Adriana giddily, "why should we not try to make some discoveries ourselves by blowing soap bubbles? They are so pretty." "Oh fie!" cried the elder girls very consequentially. But one of them immediately added, "I remember to have read in La Fontaine this excellent thought, nothing is useless to people of sense." "It is indeed a very just idea," said Madame Dernilly. "And I think, my children, you will do well to take advantage of Adriana's proposal." The matter was then put to the vote, much in the same manner as they had learned from the newspapers. The national affairs are decided in the Chamber of Deputies. Ernestina and one of the young visitors ranged themselves on the left to show that they rejected a motion for playing at such a childish game. Adriana and her companions took the right side, and they were lucky enough to secure the support of the center, of which Madame Dernilly was the only member. They had consequently a majority, and it was decided that they should play at blowing soap bubbles. "Who knows," said Aglaé, smiling, "whether we shall not, like the illustrious Newton, make some new and great discovery." This idea raised their impatience to begin, and luckily, the preparations for their experiment were soon made. A chambermaid brought some soap suds, rather thick, in a china basin. Adriana chose among some little bits of straw the one which suited best with her design, and slit the extremity in four parts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.